Amen. Good morning, church. Amen. Prelude reminding us that worship is not just a Sunday morning thing. It's a night and day thing. It's a constant moment by moment thing because God is worthy. Amen. Please stand for our call to worship. It's from Psalm 11. God's word speaks of his promise for protecting us. It talks about his holiness and his righteousness. This is God's word. In the Lord I take refuge. How can you say to my soul, flee like a bird to your mountain? For behold, the wicked bend the bow. They have fitted their arrow to the string to shoot in the dark at the upright in heart. If the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes see, his eyelids test the children of man. The Lord tests the righteous, but his soul hates the wicked and the one who loves violence. Let him rain coals on the wicked. Fire and sulfur and scorching wind shall be the portion of their cup. For the Lord is righteous. He loves righteous deeds. The upright shall behold his face. Let's continue worship as we sing, praise the Lord, ye heavens, adore him. Bow your head and pray with me. Abba, Father, we humbly bow down to worship you this morning. You are our creator. We are your creation. We praise you because you are our refuge, protecting us from evil, even the evil one. We praise you because you are holy, holy, holy. You are the only true God. We praise you because you are righteous. All of your thoughts are true. All of your works are just. We praise you because you are perfectly wise, and so we look to you for guidance and direction. We praise you because you make wonderful promises, and you keep every single one of them. We praise you that you are victorious, even over sin and death. We praise you for our salvation, a gift from you, totally undeserved and unearned. We praise you because you are perfectly powerful. Your word says that nothing is too difficult for you. We praise you because you have sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross so that we could have life, life abundant and eternal. And now we pray together the model of prayer that Jesus taught his very first follower, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And then using the Apostles' Creed, which declares the basic tenets of Orthodox Christianity, brothers and sisters in Christ, what do we believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, and the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. At this time, I invite one of our youth, Nicholas Della Rocco, to come and share his experience attending Summit.
My name's Nicholas, and earlier this year, I had the opportunity to attend Summit, which was a apologetics conference that was about 2 weeks long. And that was my first time flying out somewhere. It was in Manitou Springs, Colorado. And when I got to Colorado Airport, I think my baggage was probably the last to come out of the baggage claim, and that was the longest I think I've ever waited for something, and I was just terrified. I was like, I'm gonna be stuck in a place I don't know for 2 weeks without any clothes. After that, I figured out I didn't have any toiletries with me, but when I got there to the orientation, I went to the front desk and they were able to supply me with some stuff to last me for that 2 weeks, which was very nice of them. And when I had got there, the first day was pretty much just an orientation. I met my roommates and who I was gonna be staying with for those 2 weeks, and thankfully I didn't have any problems. They were actually great roommates. And they did this thing every morning where we had to do our bed like perfectly and everything, and they gave us room scores for going to lunch and dinner. And if we didn't get above a 20, and it was out of 30, we had to wait in the back of the line for lunch, and that was a long line. But besides all that, we didn't have to do that. I think we only had to do that once. But we had a pretty good time getting together with those guys. I'd gone into town with them and talked with them a little bit. I still keep up with a few of them. Not as much as I'd like to, but the first week was a pretty unfamiliar place for me, so I was getting settled in, and we woke up at 6 in the morning and immediately started doing lectures right after breakfast, which was at like 7:15, and it was about, I would say, maybe 6.5 hours of lectures a day, every day, maybe more, and they did pretty much covered everything you can imagine with apologetics, which I was not expecting how good they would do with that. And some of the teachers even had Q&As after where they'd pretty much answer any question you ask them. So you'd really get a good view of like different arguments and stuff that you'd see coming from somebody who's not a Christian or maybe just has problems with certain beliefs about Christianity. And they went over all the hard issues. They didn't skip anything. Abortion, pornography, and how big it is right now. And it was hard stuff. Like, they did not pull any punches. And I was very happy about that. But they did have some free days where we got a little bit of a break from all that hard stuff. And I had climbed a mountain with a few guys. And that was a lot harder than I thought it would be. It was only a mile, but up in where we were, it was about, I think the elevation was 8,000 feet, so I couldn't breathe. down here in Florida, going up there, it's like when I woke up in the morning, I ran out of breath making my bed. So, but besides that, I was able to get up there. I had to stop like three times for some air, and I was really humbled by that trip because I thought I was like, oh, I'm strong. I'll make it up this, like, no problem. These people are having so much struggle getting up here, and then immediately got humbled. So that was an interesting learning experience. I got pretty close with one of my roommates. We had gone into town on, I think it was Sunday, was our one full break day where we didn't have to do any lectures or anything. And I got to sleep in for once. But we went into town, and there's, they mentioned this at the orientation, but Manitou Springs is very new age. So there was a lot of weird shops and stuff there, but there was a few, I think, he was in one of my small groups, because you do small groups at nighttime, just not with your roommates, with a group of people they put you with and hand-selected you to be with, more around your age group. And there was one guy who actually had went and, I guess you could say, evangelized to a hippie guy. And I thought that was pretty interesting. He had a good story about that. And his, he had actually been stuck at the airport for about 3 days, so I thought I had it bad. So, but he had managed to get over there. He showed up a little bit later in the conference. And week two was also just really good. I think I only had like three teachers that I didn't like out of like the 20 that were there. And that pretty much all of them were great though. And the ones I didn't like was more just stuff that I've already heard before. But I had gone in with moderate expectations and came out with some of the greatest knowledge that I could ever ask for. Like in a debate or anything now, I feel much more confident. And they genuinely did cover everything you could possibly think of. I have plenty of notes. And even though they were just hammering you with a ton of knowledge, somehow I managed to remember a lot of that. And there was one speaker I really liked, J. Warner Wallace. He's a cold case detective, and he had done a presentation on looking at the biblical worldview from a crime scene detective and how you need an outside force to cause something, like, and going over how it wasn't a suicide or it wasn't this and that. And he basically used that to prove that God existed, and I thought that was really interesting, and he did a very good job at it. And they were very big on reading books. There was a library right in the back of the lecture hall, and every single time they had books from different people that they were like, okay, go buy this and that, and they did a lot of C.S. Lewis books, which I appreciate, because C.S. Lewis is great. And the Screwtape Letters had a book club, which I thought was funny, because I had read that book before, and I was like, oh, that's pretty neat. And yeah, I had got along with everybody fine. It was probably one of the best 2 weeks of my life. The Christian unity, I guess you could say, there was great. It was a lot of very devoted people, and they were there to learn. There was even, I think, like two guys I knew that were an atheist who had went there to try to see if like maybe this is for them, or they wanted to see the arguments, which I thought was very interesting. I had talked to him at a lunch table, but overall, it was a great trip. I don't think I'll ever really cap that. That was invaluable knowledge that will stick with me for the rest of my life. And once I got out of there, I felt much stronger as a Christian. I could not be more grateful for the church for sending me there, because they paid for everything, including my flight, and even a little bit extra for like food and stuff. So that was very nice of them. And yeah, it was great. If you have, I don't know, a kid or something that's around, I think the cap age is 23. It's like 16 or 17 to 23. I would absolutely send them. But that was most of it. If you have any questions, you can ask me, feel free. That'll be all.
I heard a voice of
This is God's word from Psalm 145. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand. You satisfy the desire of every living thing. Pray with me. Father, we praise your name and thank you that you are the giver of all things. We thank you that true satisfaction rests in you in a personal relationship with you through your Son. We thank you and praise your name that you are so open-handed and generous toward us, your people. We pray that you would take these, your tithes and our offerings above and beyond that. Father, you would use them to glorify your name, to lift up the name of Jesus Christ, and to point others to a relationship with you, both here locally and far, far away and everywhere in between. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
Joyous now to sing your praises and to enter into your joy as we glorify you and love you and know who we are as your people. And as we know you better as our King, we pray the blessing then on the reading and hearing and receiving and proclamation of this, your holy word. In Jesus' name, amen. In chapter 25, Jesus gives three parables about things to come. We're in the second of those parables, parable of the talents, the word of God. For it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted to them his property. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to each according to his ability. And then he went away. He who had received the 5 talents went at once and traded with them, and he made 5 talents more. So also he who had the 2 talents made 2 talents more. But he who had received the 1 talent went and dug in the ground and hid his master's money. Now, after a long time, the master of those servants came and settled accounts with them. And he who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 talents more, saying, Master, you delivered to me 5 talents. Here I have made 5 talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. And he also, who had the 2 talents, came forward, saying, Master, you delivered to me 2 talents. Here, I have made 2 talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. He also, who had received the 1 talent, came forward, saying, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours. But his master answered him, You wicked and slothful servant. You knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers. And at my coming, I should have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has the 10 talents. For to everyone who has will more be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Identity. Identity. That has been where Matthew has been building layer upon layer upon layer of observations on Jesus' life, on Jesus' teachings, on Jesus' actions. The Gospel of Matthew is written so that we know who Jesus really is. And so we're to read it and consider it and take it for what it is. And then we have, on top of that, the extra layers of 2,000 years of the history of the church repeatedly confirming this same identity of Jesus as the Christ. The Caesarea Philippi Confession of Faith that we read and considered back in chapter 16, where Jesus said, And who do you say that I am? He asked his disciples, Who do you say that I am? And Peter said, You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And so for 16 chapters, Matthew had been providing eyewitness testimony about Jesus to make known his identity. And then shares with us how Peter and the disciples came to confess his identity. And then the next 12 chapters of Matthew follow and continue to testify to and to confirm that identity. So this morning I asked, Do you know your king? Do you know your king? Webb Boye, for years, led our grace ministry, and in meeting with people to discuss their needs, he would always ask them, And what do you say about this man, Jesus? He understood that the greatest need for anyone is to know who Jesus is and then respond accordingly. And that we will and do respond in some manner. We do. All people, when they hear about Jesus, respond in some manner. It is to acknowledge him as Lord and King. It is to disavow him of that position. And worst of all is to say, eh, but so what? But what about you? Do you know your King? Having taught about eschatology, the last things throughout chapter 24, Jesus immediately taught in three very urgent parables regarding these things. In the parable we looked at last week, the wise and foolish virgins, Jesus dealt with confusion regarding the time of his second coming. And the essential response is to always be ready. That's how we respond to that. Are you ready? Are you prepared? Do you have oil in your lamp? That is, have you acknowledged Jesus for who he is, repented of your own sin, received his forgiveness as the King of glory, as the God of grace? Have you received that gift from him and you look to him? Are you ready for that time when he comes? We don't want to wait to the very last possible moment and say, but hopefully I'll have time to get things right just as that first sound of the trumpet is heard. We don't want to do that. We have already covered the third parable. We did that during Advent season last December as we prepared to celebrate Jesus' first Advent, the Incarnation, Christmas. Advent is a season not only in preparation for Christmas, but most especially it is a time that we're preparing and thinking about the second Advent. That even as Jesus came on the scene in a way that was unexpected in that first Advent, that he will come again. And so we know that he's coming, and we are to prepare for that. And so he told the parable of the sheep and the goats, which is the next parable in this chapter. And there was confusion over the day of judgment. And that harkens back to earlier in Jesus' ministry when he gave the Sermon on the Mount in chapter 7. What divides the sons and daughters of the kingdom from those who have indeed done things for Jesus? Didn't we do this in your name? But never really knew their master. That's what we find in that third parable, like the third servant in the parable of the talents. And so here in this second parable, the parable of the talents, the confusion is over identity. It's confusion regarding the true character of the master. And remember, this is just a couple days before he's going to the cross. There's an urgency that they understand who he is and what he's about. There's an urgency for us that we understand who he is and his character. It's crucial that Jesus' identity be understood, that we don't just make up our own version of Jesus and say, well, this is who he is to me, this is who he is to me. And Jesus gets to say who he is. And we have to hear his identity. And so the parable focuses on what faithfulness should or should not look like in the time that remains until he returns. That's a question for all of us who are waiting for the Lord's return. What does faithfulness look like? Will he find us faithful? Well done, good and faithful servant, he says. And so it opens with the news that a man is leaving on a journey and that he expects to be gone for a significant time. Verse 19, a long time. Do you think Jesus has been gone a long time? Yes. 2,000 years is in the category of a long time. And this master divides between three servants an enormous amount of resources. He must have been extremely wealthy because later he's going to refer to what he had given them. Verses 21 and 23 is that you were faithful over a little. Okay, this is Elon Musk kind of money we're talking about here. Really. The English language uses the word talent to refer to what? Our natural abilities, our natural aptitudes. We've been entertained for years by what? America's got talent. And sometimes it's a yes and sometimes it's a no. But America's got talent. But the talent in the parable is not that kind of talent. It's actually a weight. It's a weight, and its value then depends on what? What's being weighed? So is it copper? Or is it silver? Or is it gold? But the weight of it is what's in view here. And the implications of the parable, again, is that this was a considerable sum, okay? We encounter a number of times throughout the New Testament stories about a denarii. And a denarii is a day's wages for the everyday worker. This is not denarii, okay? He's not going away for a long time, and he gives them a week's worth of pay and says, do something with this for me. He gives them a significant sum of money. And in the story, the talents were given to the several men according to their abilities. He's not saying everyone gets the same thing. He gives it discerning the abilities they have. And for our purposes, it might be best to interpret the talents as opportunities. Because the value of money is not in itself. That's not its worth. It's in the opportunities it opens. And since our chief end is to glorify and enjoy God forever, it's the opportunities then to glorify and enjoy God with the resources that we have. It may provide food and shelter for yourself and loved ones. For many, that's as far as it's going to stretch, and to be faithful in doing just that is faithfulness. And it's the opportunity to do that. It may provide food and shelter for many people through farming or through construction or other enterprises. It may provide more opportunity through education or technology investment. And related, greater risk also should give a greater reward. Every risk does not work out, does it? There can be a loss. So greater talents, greater opportunities, is greater responsibility. And the goal is not that everybody ends up the same regardless of what they do. If that was really supposed to be the goal, Jesus just teed up the perfect time to drive that point home. And he doesn't. Because that's not the goal. Jesus sums this up in a similar context as he's teaching parables regarding being ready for his second coming in Luke chapter 12, concluding about responsibility. He says, Luke 12:48, everyone to whom much was given, of him much will be required. And from him to whom they entrusted much, they will demand the more. God calls us to be faithful with opportunities he gives us in life. We're not to bury them until Jesus returns. We have the opportunity to multiply what Christ has entrusted to us. Jesus does not say that everyone received the same amount. We've observed that. The master knows his servants well enough to divide the resources and the opportunities according to their abilities. Because the people that he's giving them to belong to him, and the resources belong to him. We belong to him, and our opportunities are from him as well. And so the recognition is that they were good and faithful with what they had. Spurgeon makes this observation: it is not well done, good and brilliant servant. Perhaps the man never shone at all in the eyes of those who appreciate glare and glitter. In other words, the world might not be giving any acclamations to the person. Spurgeon goes on, "It is not well done, great and distinguished servant, for it's possible the man was never known beyond his native village." It is well done, good and faithful servant. And the master returns from his long time away. He calls the servants to come and to give an account for themselves. And with the first and second, they hear the words, I would submit, that we all long to hear one day. Well done, good and faithful servant. Well done. And in like in chapter 24, verse 47, truly I say to you, he will set him over all his possessions, was what we read there as Jesus is talking about expectations of his return. The responsibility of faithful servants, don't miss this, they're increased as a reward. They're increased as a reward. Freedom from the master is not the reward. That's not what we're shooting for. And one day I will be free of Jesus and I will no longer have to be his servant. Serving the master is the reward. And the intimacy of sharing in his joy is our reward. Verses 21 and 23, enter into the misery of your master. No, enter into the joy of your master. We are welcome to share in the eternal joy of our Lord. We, if you're in Christ, we are welcome to share in the eternal joy of our master. Let that sink in. But notice, we each have to give an account for ourselves. The servant entrusted with the smallest portion, and it's still a sizable amount that he was asked to be a steward of, fails to fulfill even the lesser expectations. The reason? Well, he blames the severity of the master, not his slothfulness. Oh no, it's the severity of the master. And his excuse? The master is a hard man, he says. And so he says, here, have what is yours. I went and dug it up for you. And he refuses to acknowledge his responsibility. A responsibility that he easily enough could have fulfilled. Having already failed the master's trust, he now proceeds to insult the master. Because according to the third servant, the master's expectations are just impossible. He expects to reap, to gather in what he hasn't sown. He's a taker, is what he is. But given the evidence of the parable, that's the farthest thing from the truth. The master has sown probably hundreds of thousands of dollars. And he's tempered his expectations according to their abilities. And so the final excuse offered was that he was afraid. And so he just simply hid the money. He didn't want to take any risk at all. Beloved, as Christians, we can get overwhelmed by the tasks, the responsibilities given to us. The magnitude of the task. What is the gospel task? Take the gospel into the entire world. All right, Mac, get on it. That's not a one-person job. How will we ever fulfill the Great Commission? The gospel to the whole world? And as we think about that, it's easy to start thinking, well, you know, I can't do that much. What I do doesn't really matter. When you say that to yourself, you should smell some smoke. because it's a lie from the pit of hell. When we invest in a Nicholas, we have no idea what the Lord's going to do in his life. But we're a part of it. As we help Sarah Kate raise money, she, next 2 years she wants to go and serve with YWAM, helping to equip and stir other young people to taking the gospel to the world. We've already invested in Sarah Kate, and we'll do it again. And we're all a part. If you're a part of that, you're a part of that. That's how God takes the gospel to the world. Don't be overwhelmed with it. God isn't. But he has said that that's part of our responsibility. And so we do that. We engage. The master has no joy with the third servant. Basically, if his character is truly what was described by that servant, if the master's just a difficult and stern master, and he asks him, well, why didn't you just stick it in the bank and get the interest you would have given? Why didn't you do that? There would have been some return. And he suggests that if he had just done something that yielded even a small return, that would have been acceptable. We do what we can with what we have been given, the opportunities that are before us, and we do them unto the glory of God. The results are in his hands. But we want to be faithful along the way. The master repeats one of the upside-down virtues of the kingdom. Verse 29, for to everyone who has will be given more. It's upside down, isn't it? And in God's economy, it works perfectly. Jesus had spoken in this manner at the conclusion of the parable of the soils back in chapter 13. And so there is confusion upon the return of the master. Some will be afraid at his coming because they never really understood his loving kindness. And though they might try to use their confusion as an excuse for their lack of fruit, they won't be excused. Even the productive servants will still not yet grasp how manifestly gracious and generous the master is when they witness him blessing those who are already blessed with even deeper, incalculable blessings. Enter into the joy of your master. Beloved, do you know your king? Clearly, one of the servants did not. Do you know your king? If we think he's strict and critical with people, we'll likely be afraid to take risks with the talents and opportunities that we have. If I don't do everything perfectly, if it doesn't work out, I may be disowned. I may disappoint him. And then I will not do all to glorify and enjoy God forever. If I think he's a harsh king, if I think that he reaps where he doesn't sow, that all I have is my own and it's for my personal enrichment, and God's trying to take away from me and make me less, then I'll not do all to glorify and enjoy God forever. If I do not really know the King, I will live an impoverished life even now, missing the joy of the Master now and in a greater way forever. Do you know your King? For the past 25 years, my favorite reminder to think more deeply and seriously and biblically and joyously about our King is captured in the portion of a message by the Reverend S.M. Lockridge. Shadrach Meshach Lockridge. That man was born to be a preacher, wasn't he? Do you know your King? And I've shared it, I think, twice with our congregation over the last 25 years. We're going to hear it again because just talking about it in the office, I said, I'm thinking the passage, the title is going to be, Do You Know Your King? And immediately Cindy in the office said, He's my King. That's to know the King. It changes everything in life that we may glorify and enjoy Him daily and forever. Do you know your King?
My King was born King. The Bible says He's a seven-way King. He's a King of the Jews. That's a racial King. He's a King of Israel. That's a national King. He's a King of righteousness. He's a King of the ages. He's a King of heaven. He's a King of glory. He's a King of kings, and He is the Lord of lords. Now that's my King. Well, I wonder if you know Him. Do you know Him? Don't try to mislead me. Do you know my King? David said the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth His handiwork. My King is the only one whom there are no means of measure can define His limitless love. No far-seeing telescope can bring into visibility the coastline of His surely supply. No barriers can hinder Him from pouring out His blessing. Well, He's enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. And He's impartially merciful. That's my King. He's God's Son. He's a sinner's Savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He stands alone in Himself. He's august. He's unique. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He's supreme. He's preeminent. Well, He's the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the supreme problem in high criticism. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He's the cardinal necessity of spiritual religion. And that's my King. He's the miracle of the age. He's the superlative of everything good that you choose to call Him. Well, He's the only one able to supply all of our needs simultaneously. He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and He saves. He's strong God and He guides. He heals the sick. He cleanses the leprous. He forgives sinners. He discharges debtors. He delivers the captives. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And He beautifies the meek. Do you know Him? Well, my King is a King of knowledge. He's a wellspring of wisdom. He's a doorway of deliverance. He's a pathway of peace. He's the roadway of righteousness. He's the highway of holiness. He's the gateway of glory. He's the master of the mighty. He's the captain of the conquerors. He's the head of the heroes. He's the leader of the legislator. He's the overseer of the overcomers. He's the governor of governors. He's the prince of princes. He's the King of kings. And He's the Lord of lords. That's my King. Yeah. His office is manifold. His promise is sure. His light is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. His yoke is easy and His burden is light. Well, I I wish I could describe him to you, but he's indescribable. He's indescribable. Yeah. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. I'm trying to tell you, the heavens of heavens cannot contain him, let alone a man explaining him. You can't get him out of your mouth. You can't get him off of your hands. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. The witnesses couldn't get their testimonies to agree. And Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. That's my king. Yeah! He always has been, and he always will be. I'm talking about he had no predecessor, and he'll have no successor. There was nobody before him, and there'll be nobody after him. You can't impeach him, and he's not going to resign. That's my king. Is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Hey! All the power belongs to my king. We around here talking about black power and white power and green power, but it's God's power. Thine is the power. Yeah! And the glory. We finally get prestige and honor and glory for ourselves, but the glory is all his. Yes, thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever and ever and ever. How long is that? And ever and ever and ever and ever. And when you get through with all of the forever, then amen.
Do you know him? That's 7 minutes of superlatives. And I think he could have gone on longer. Do you know him? I need those reminders, and I play that every so often. And I never get tired of it. Lord, you call us over the tumults of all kinds of struggles of life. You give us what we need to be faithful, to glorify and enjoy you now and forever. Oh, if we only know you, help us to know you. In Jesus' name, amen. Sing together, Jesus Calls Us, number 592.
Oh,
call is to be faithful, and the Lord even gives us what we need to do that and encourages us with every step of faithfulness. The world didn't like that. It'll always tell you what you didn't do right. Jesus, do you know him? The grace of this Lord and King Jesus. The love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest with you, abide with you, go with you, that you would know him better and better and better. Amen.